let's get into Paradigm. This was a crazy song because it was pretty much created solely on jamming with Brooks. And we liked it so much that it was one of the first times we'd ever written in this way. We always methodically planned things out before. And this was one where we were just going off a feel. And you can really tell. And I think the first thing we came up with was this drum rhythm that Brooks had. So yeah. We should get into the drum rhythm real quick.
It's like a tribal pretty shuffle.
Pretty shuffle.
Switches up just a little bit for the verse. He plays with rhythms like that really, really well.
Yeah.
It's like triplets, but then he goes in four.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
He's okay.
If you bring up just the guitars, what you're really playing there is pretty intricate.
Yeah, it's
pretty clean.
It's actually busier than it sounds, you know? So I'm trying to like outline the chords so you can fucking sing over it and it not be a pain in the ass, but...
And then on the very intro of this, we had these big tom hits. And one thing we did in the studio is we down-tuned the tom heads and just had Brooks in there slamming on them. So let's hear those real quick.
Okay, here now.
For anyone who cares, the reason we do that is because the tom tone we're going to be using on such a fast rhythm is going to be a smaller tone and a clickier, bitier tone so that it cuts through the mix. But for that initial part where you need a lot of power and a lot of weight behind it, but a lot of room, helps someone like Andy Wallace get a lot more out of the power in the initial hit there. This was a song that was really difficult for us to settle on the vocal melody we wanted. Because we didn't want anything too typical. We wanted something a little bluesy and more laid back and drugged out, we always call it, using interesting notes. And there was a lot of stuff going on with the guitars.
Yeah.
And so...
And the guitar, when you listen to that isolated track, it's got more of a gothic novelty sort of vibe. You know, you could probably easily just sing some really goofy shit over it and call it a day, but we wanted it to be serious.
But then another thing that you learn from transcribing other bands, a lot of times the shit they're doing without the other thing with it is goofy.
Yeah.
And you're like, wow, that's like sounds like pop. But the vocal melody makes it sound dark. So we just kept on it, and we knew we needed to make it cool in some way.
Yeah, we picked a vibe and we stuck to it.
Yep. You see, you can sing goodbye,
but you don't have to die, not ever. Weird. Definitely. Weird rhythms in there, you know?
Then we had the harmony on. Engineer
the wires to your brain. Which is the chord of that second... So what you're singing is the chord of the second chord, and you'll see it like resolve into that second chord. Same notes. And then it resolves right into it. It's kind of foreshadowing something there.
And harmony's got cheesy on this part.
Yeah.
This felt better as a single vocal.
And then I failed at Pro Tools.
What are you doing here?
Yeah, so I guess to backtrack a little bit during some of these verses in between. We'll add some stuff just for flavor and shit, just little texture stuff, you know?
There's like a little bit of Soundgarden influence.
Totally.
A little dirty.
Grungy. Which is just weird.
Yeah.
If you don't, you'll never hear it in there. But it just gives it that, comes in, but it's still there. Yeah.
So then going into this pre-chorus, we just wanted something smoother. So what we did was we used the old school tape machine and you put a phaser on the vocals.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's on here necessarily. We kind of sent it back to Joe Breezy back in LA.
Right.
He did it and sent it back out to Andy Wallace. So when you're listening in headphones, it feels like the vocals flipping.
Yeah.
This is probably the original effect.
Totally. Let's see what this one is. There's that the phased one, yeah.
There you go.
It's cool.
Then again, sticking with like one vocal, not doing too many harmonies, making it too pretty.
Yeah.
This chorus took us forever to write. And I think it was actually a joke.
What was written, it was like the second thing that we came up with. And then we're listening to all of our options and we couldn't figure it out. We were super fucking frustrated.
We must have moved on for a long time.
Yeah, we
and
did.
And then we came back and you and Johnny liked it.
Yeah.
And we're like, really? Okay. I think it was just the initial note, the way up and God inside, and then we came up with na 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 na.
Right.
So it needed work, like, you know, like so many things we go through, but it worked out. It's one of my favorite songs, and the chorus is one of the main parts of that.
Yeah. Sometimes cool to put those things in there, identify little things. Punk rock trick, actually. Yep. It's fucking NoFX 101, octaves. Uh-oh. Got a little low vocal. Needs a little exposing over here.
Yeah, and the scream. Let's go straight from the low vocal into the scream. No paradigm.
So funny to hear these things by himself. Fucking crazy.
Some reverb. Yeah. And I think one thing that's important for people writing songs, the verses don't have to be the same. It's actually better if they're not. Verse one, he's doing something completely different on the lead guitar. And verse two, threw all that out the window, is doing something different on this one. This was a perfect example of why I was so excited about this record and working with Brooks. We said, okay, well, where do we go from here? There's a million things you could do out of this.
Right.
That would be typical. But he came up with this disco, like hi-hat. It's like, what the fuck?
Totally.
And it was so cool because it's like, okay, we're going. And then we just went crazy with it. You know, every change after this is like, what the fuck are you guys doing? Which kind of became the theme of the record, in a way.
Completely. Whoops. Swing you.
So if you had your solo in there, it sounds like it's a bunch of ants like building a wall. Like,
right.
Like, what the fuck? And this was just jamming. We didn't write these notes out. We just started going up the scale.
Yeah.
Then we were jamming. I was playing the rhythm. You were playing solo. It's like solo time.
Yeah.
And they were kind of like, okay, time's up. What's next?
Right. Yeah.
Just making sure we don't get bored.
Totally. Totally. So yeah, just to go over the solos real fast. A little bit of reverb. But that's pretty much just Helwin and the guitar. It's just got a weird sound in the studio. Real nasally and a little tapping at the end, and then this is the affected one. It's like when you take it out, it's like sloppy and it's got all these artifacts in it, you know? But it's all part of the vibe. Yeah, it's just fucking joke time. We're just leaving. Like, that's a lot of noise.
Well, yeah, put that with the drums. And what I think is interesting is I just don't think there's anything about this that is heavy metal. He's playing shit on a different level, in my opinion. The shit he's doing, his cymbal work with that solo. And if you play the solo with the drums there, I just think it's so interesting because I don't think you hear this kind of stuff. There's a lot of things going on. It's almost like a sped up, like, doo-wop, like...
Right.
Like a shuffle.
It's totally a shuffle. These things.
And that was one thing I loved.
Yeah, that fill is just digga 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 digga. He's doing fours out of threes.
Yeah, so not those, and those are funny things that like we Brooks can do that shit all day.
Yeah.
And we had to definitely promote it to him, like keep doing shit like that.
Yeah, just get bizarre.
And like, listen, it's a tough listen at first. You think stuff's off, you don't know what's going on. You can't listen to it once and get it. It's just not possible.
Yeah.
And little things like that are what you grow to love the most because they're the most different.
Totally.
So,
you know, by learning what things work over doing a multitude of albums with awesome people like Joe Barisi, you know, like, this is what kind of tone I want to do, what do you think? And then he sets up these insane soundscapes, and then you just start playing crazy shit.
We get this build up into this last chorus.
Part two keeps building, keeps building. Yeah. Let's break some of that shit down a little bit.
You can experiment with your choruses by lengthening them, adding guitars behind it.
Yeah, it's pretty much just a reharmonized chorus. We're doing the same exact thing, but making the chords a little bit more somber. We're always fighting on, do we do five different bridges? Are we going to make this the most adventurous song? And then we get more excited when we can take that adventurous nature and get it done like lickety split in way more concise form.
Yep, let's hear the end with just the embellishments.
It's going to just hit this mandolin part up real fast. So. Yeah, so kind of crazy.
Yep. And we had some other parts written for that, but that was one that felt best with the song.
Yeah.
I think the other part was actually better.
We liked it at the time, and I remember wanting it so bad. And I think back in the day, we probably would have left both of them.
Yeah,
you know?
Totally.
At least chosen the other one, even though this one made more sense, you know? That is cool. Love the piano. Again, that pedal tone or pedal chord up top. The moving bass line, keeping the vibe. Yeah, so it has a motif there, you know, it's not just...
Let's hear it with the power chords.
Here's some fucking power chords.
Yep. It reminds me of like Ozzy or something.
Totally.
Very dark.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, even listening back to the other songs, like the vocal recording stuff, like to me, this just blows all those things away because it's so real and it's a mixed voice, head voice with the mixed voice, and just you can hear the depth between the lows and the highs. It's a different fucking tone. And to me, that's going to be so much more powerful moving forward. And I remember recording this song first, and then Zach and me were talking about how different the vocals sounded, and I was like, does it really sound different? He's like, no, not to me really. And then when the record came out, everyone's like, what the fuck? The vocals are... It was almost as shocking as when we released City of Evil, and I thought, this doesn't sound that much different than Waking the Fallen. And then it came out, and everyone's like, what the fuck? Yeah, no, the vocals sound different. And and this is like years of working on trying to get that to where I have all that range, and I can sing it easily and just do it. And so when I hear that soloed up like that, I'm just like, it's fucking cool.
Yeah, and because of that, you get a more pure take. You know, we left a lot of, like, I guess, idiosyncrasies and character in that. If you just belted out this note perfectly, or the inflection of how you said something was there, but it's bookended by maybe, like, something that's slightly out of tune or a crack or whatever, we left all that shit, which we never would have ever done. And you just hear tons of raw personality and intent throughout every song.
I mean, if you break apart Queen stuff and you break apart Pink Floyd stuff and you take just the vocals and you listen to it, there's voices cracking, there's voices wobbling, there's out of tune stuff.
Yeah.
But the overall product is just so much better.
It's real.
It's real. So it's cool. So Paradigm.